You know, I've been 5 years with the other brand, and to change to a new brand is always a bit difficult, I would say, in the beginning.
You know, in this game, results give you the confidence. Results breed more good results. And
you're ready to go, mate. There's nothing you can't do.
He needs to know that what he's capable of.
See, he moet je rechtop gaan zitten. He's, kijk, rechtop zitten. Niet vooruit, rechtop moet je. Je moet hem voelen. So, you need to fool us.
What can he say about me? Because he knows me for 3 years, you know, and still he comes with new things and...
Accent Renault. Well, it's going to be a big moment for him, isn't it? With the overall here and Maxi Basin.
I think that most people are surprised that Maxime Renault has been dominant in the MX2 class at the halfway mark, but really, this shouldn't be a surprise at all. Maxime was tipped to be a world champion and a great of the sport from his early EMX 125 days. A rider like Tom Vial, in comparison, wasn't. Vial was never expected to be a world champion. Renault was. What he's doing now is merely fulfilling expectations. Like, this shouldn't be a surprise. Injury after injury for his EMX 125, EMX 250, and eventually MX2 days kind of derailed his career for a portion there. He just struggled to gain momentum and didn't really make much progress through the years like 2016, 2017. But now he's back on a factory team. He has some momentum. He has confidence. And we're seeing the result of that. It's definitely not a surprise that he's been the dominant figure in MX2. And if he goes on to win the MX2 title, which halfway through the 2021 season, it definitely looks like he will. That wouldn't be a shock either. Renault should be this good.
He had the speed. He's always had the talent. We've always believed that he could be the next MX2 world champion. But he had such a bad run with injuries. Like he explained, his shoulder, he did a lot of damage to there, and then his elbow, and that was a result of another rider landing on him.
Yeah, I think this is kind of a moment that made me just realizing I have one life, I have one career. I almost messed it up with a crash that was not even really my fault. The rider jumped on me, so I'm just trying to give my best every time I have my wheels on the track and enjoying, just trying to get as much pleasure as I can and just playing, because that's all it is about, you know, and this is helping me for sure, because I see it as a second chance, and you don't have so many times a second chance, you know, so no pressure at all.
On my way to Kegums, we are here in Brussels, Belgium. So yeah, heading for the 7th round of the season. Really looking forward to that round because the track is really nice. So yeah, just follow me during my trip. Just arrived here in Latvia, in Riga. So it's now 10 p.m. We just take the location car and then we are going to our hotel and have a good sleep for tomorrow, Friday, going maybe at the track and have a little look at the layout. So yeah, have a good night, guys. See you tomorrow. It's Saturday. We're now heading to the test track to do some start practices. Just to get the first feeling with the bike for the weekend and see if everything is okay on the bike. So yeah, let's go for it.
I had so much injuries and one really big one in 2017. I was not even sure to ride again a bike. You know, I had some nerve problem in my left arm, and yeah, on those moments was really tough. And but yeah, I rocked as much as I could, and so now I enjoy even more being here, because I know where I passed through, and it's just full pleasure now, and enjoying every moment of it.
My name is Thierry van den Bosch. I'm training Maxime for 3.5 years now. Going very well, you know, he's improving himself every year, and a big step this year. Hopefully keep on going this way until the end of the season.
Faudra que je vois, de toute façon je regarderai le mécanisme, mais faudra que je vois comment je suis placé sur la moto à peu près. Je pense que je serai à peu près comme ça, je pense, à peu près, au niveau taille. Comme ça, tu vois bien, là.
Track looks really nice, bumpy and sketchy some places, so really have to get the focus for tomorrow.
Si tu arrives à vraiment cabrer celle-là, pour passer au-dessus, déjà tu gagnes de la vitesse, et après c'est de la vitesse que tu gardes jusqu'au bout des vagues, quoi. Tu vois, si tu arrives à repasser au-dessus de celle-là et pas atterrir ici et faire pam et rebondir. Parce que si tu atterris là, les deux roues, tu peux pas faire grand chose, hein, je pense.
Celle-là, ou la scrubber ou quoi, faire l'absorber, cabrer ici un peu.
Ouais.
On va venir chercher.
Et après là, réussir par contre à faire double.
My expectations for tomorrow are for sure getting some really good points in the championship and keep on going on the same way of riding since the beginning of the year. So yeah, I'm just gonna now try to focus tonight and get ready for tomorrow.
Track. It's 7:44, so yeah, just getting ready slowly for the warm-up at 9:15, and then ready to start the day. Morning.
All good?
Ready to rumble?
Yeah.
So he's come a long way, but like in terms of his ability, his work ethic, his determination, he's undoubtedly like the most determined rider on the line, I would say.
Yeah, now I'm starting the day with going to prepare my stuff a little bit, and then going to the physio. So I'm gonna have just a little checkup and releasing a little bit some muscles and getting fully ready and fully focused for the practice to get some good feelings on the track, and then before both motos I will go back to the physio, have a little manipulation, let's say, and be ready. Yeah, actually my arm is not 100%. I don't talk so much about it because I don't want to, there is no excuse. I mean, I'm used to it and it's not a problem for me as in the riding, but my left arm is for sure less strong than the right arm. I still have sensibility problem on my two fingers, on the index and the middle one. And I'm just used to it now. You know, I don't feel my clutch with the two fingers. I just feel it a different way, you know, just not sensitive, but feel it as a movement. But I'm used to it and it's not a big problem. I can perform on a high level with it, so this is not a problem. I'm just going through it. Never got my ass slapped like that.
Done?
Yeah.
Thank you.
See you.
Maxime Renault once again, 30.7, so only a tenth off. Sector 2, imminent as he enters Sector 3, almost now-ish. And Maxime Renault, is it green again or 32.1? Maxime Renault moves up to second, 0.4, so the gap's still coming down. There's still some life left in the track. Let's go through the confirmation then. JBay on pole for Rockstar Energy Husqvarna, ahead of Maxime Renault.
Practice went pretty good. Finished second in the time practice, so really good gate pick for the motos. Feeling with the track is quite good. Actually, it's tricky and some sharp bumps, but I feel really good, feel comfortable. So yeah, just try to make two good starts in the motos and go for a good result. I've been in a rehab center, you know, with I think during 4 or 5 months. And I think the bigger thing that helped me was that I was in the center with people that were really, really in a bad situation. And seeing how they were just enjoying the life and smiling and always have the joke in them, saying a joke or something, you know, I was like, I cannot complain. I have my two legs, my two arms. One was not working so good, but I could have done, yeah, could have been so worse. So yeah, it was just, you cannot just say, I'm done. You have to work, and if you want something, just go get it. And that's what I did. And I just worked so hard and always believed in that. And one day, the nerves started to react a little bit. And from there, we worked on it, and it came back. So yeah, that was a little bit kind of a redemption, you know. And mentally, I think I'm ready to give it all. And I will never, ever stop, and never ever always believe, you know. So that's also a strong point.
Riders making their way to the start line. Ahead of the next two, race one is dedicated. We've got rising temperatures. The Italian, this is for the lead, and he does. He's got that corner absolutely dialed. Maxime Renault on the home stretch. He came through with a little bit of traffic at the beginning. He set fast lap after fast lap. He goes on to win race one here.
Yeah, really happy with it. I got a good start, but not the best, actually. I think I was fifth. And then I pushed really hard.
Good job.
I'm surprised, but he's doing even better in the key moments of the championship. The right moment when the others are a little bit in trouble, bam, is there taking the most of the points. The moment where someone is popping up and saying, like, maybe I can fight with him, bam, he's winning again. So he's doing it very, very well. I will not be surprised if at the end of the season he can win the championship.
Yeah, for sure, this is something that gonna make me feel complete. I mean, I worked for it since I'm a kid. I'm dreaming about it since I'm a kid. Getting that world title in 1-5 was also something that was part of the way of following, you know. And then getting those two injuries also get me a little slap in the face, you know, and wakes me up about, don't think this world title gonna come easy, you know. You have to work for it. We are so many young and talented riders in the world, and yeah, you just have to want it more than the others. And now I feel like I'm ready this year. I've put the job in, and but yeah, there's always a part of unknown, you know. So, but yeah, I have the red plate. I feel good. My bike is working really good. I feel in shape. We will see this season how it will end.
I made a big push in the first 15 minutes, and then just yeah, cruise mode. So it was not pushing all the moto, you know. I tried to make some quick passes, and I think after 10 minutes I was second and charged to the front because he was already a little bit gone, and I passed him I think at half moto more or less. Made a little gap and was fine.
There is your championship leader. Well, Maxime Renaud started the day 26 points clear, and after beating Guadagnini, his closest rival, in race one, that gap has now gone out to 29 points as we head into race two. Renault bringing his A game today. It's going to be the perfect day for the Frenchman. Took 3 points out of his rival, Mattia Guadagnini, in race one. He's going to take another 5 points out of him here in race two. On his way down to the line there, Maxime Renaud. He started the lap 2.1 seconds clear. He's been pretty much immaculate all day. He crosses the line, goes 1-1 for the first time in his career. He wins the Grand Prix. Maxime Renaud continues to lead the championship in MX2. And your overall podium today, Maxime Renaud, Iago Kiat, Mattia Guadagnini.
You obviously had riders like Gauthier Poulin, who challenge for world titles, Marvin Muscan, who was a world champion twice, but Romain Fevre has kind of really led the way for aspiring French riders who want to be a star in the MX2B series. He obviously, his road to the top was unorthodox. He definitely did it a different way to most riders, but he's been the shining light for French fans for quite a while now.
The first year in 2015, yeah, I was rookie in the class. You know, you are coming, you don't expect anything. I was on the factory team with a new bike and everything. I was learning everything every time I was on the bike. And yeah, he has a good feeling, good vibes, and I was just enjoying. And when you are rookie, you don't care about so much the result, and you just try to get some experience. And then, yeah, that year everything clicked, and yeah, we win many races, many GPs, and the world title, of course, so.
Romain Fevre is about to make history here, a rookie winning in the MXGP class. He wins the race, and he will now realize it.
It was, let's say, mentally, it was maybe the easiest year that I had. But like to win, If I win at the end of the season, it will be 6 years after my world title, my first world title. So it can be for sure a good one, especially with all the hard years that I had in the past, and for my team too, because I think Kawasaki has never been world champion on the 450. So I would like, yes.
What I tend to look for when I go to places are things that are visually appealing. When you walk down the sand dunes here in St. Lucia, just thinking of the old shipwrecks or the explorers, the first thing they saw was these long beaches and impenetrable forest. They still look exactly the same. I can't imagine there are many places in the world where you can see tons of things in one day. I want to pinch my arm and say, this can't be true. I'm in the middle of this. I think the uniqueness is that it's diverse. You could peel off layer after layer and you'll find more and more things. It's all here for you to just be part of.
I have given him absolute authority.
October 20th, 1973. In Washington, a chapter during the Watergate scandal known as the Saturday Night Massacre. President Richard Nixon orders the firing of Archibald Cox, the Watergate special prosecutor. But Attorney General Elliot Richardson refuses. Both he and Deputy Attorney General William Ruckelshaus resign. Acting Attorney General Robert Bork ultimately fires Cox, a move that fuels calls for Nixon's impeachment. 1944. During World War II, General Douglas MacArthur keeps his promise of, I shall return to the Philippines. MacArthur steps ashore as American forces liberate the islands conquered by the Japanese 2.5 years earlier. 1947. The Cold War heats up on Capitol Hill. The House Un-American Activities Committee opens hearings into alleged communist influence and infiltration within America's motion picture industry. 2004. U.S. Army Staff Sergeant Ivan Chip Frederick pleads guilty to abusing Iraqi detainees at Abu Ghraib prison. He's the highest ranking of the dozen soldiers convicted in the scandal following the American-led invasion of Iraq. Frederick is paroled after serving about 3 years of an 8-year sentence. 1968. Former First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy marries Aristotle Onassis, the Greek shipping tycoon on the island of Scorpios. And 1977. Tragedy strikes the rock band Lynyrd Skynyrd. Three of the band's members are killed when their chartered plane crashes near Macomb, Mississippi. Today in history, October 20th. Tim McGuire, The Associated Press.
In our studio, and in today's news,